Hello. Welcome to another edition of the Mike Zielinski Show. I'm Mike Zielinski. I'm very honored today to have as my guest Wesley Muckey, who is a potter with a very impressive backstory from Nolde Forest Pottery. Welcome, Wesley.
Thanks for having me.
Wesley's client list, not to drop names here, but includes people like Oprah Winfrey, Billy Idol, Tommy Lee, William H. Macy, other members of rock groups, including Def Leppard, and five American presidents. Started with the Clintons, and Jimmy Carter, Gerald Ford, George W. Bush, and Barack Obama. Yeah. So enough of me. Yeah. Tell me, you know, how did this, well, first of all, you and I have a shared connection.
Yes, we do.
This all started, Ferdy Kozala, yep. For people who may not remember, was an outstanding football coach and player at Conrad Weiser. You were a Conrad Weiser graduate.
Sure, absolutely.
And Ferdy, quarterback Syracuse with Jim Brown, the Hall of Famer, and he won so many championships with Conrad Weiser. Mm-hmm. But he was a wonderful art teacher.
Absolutely.
And he got you involved with pottery.
He sure did.
And so tell me a little bit about that, and also the other teacher you had who you later worked with, Lester Breininger.
Sure. So, I started pottery with Ferdy because I had finished up most of what I was doing, the paintings. So he gave me like some choices to do other things. So I did pottery. And Lester Breininger was a biology teacher there. And he owned a pottery shop. And he would always hire kids from school to do the work because he was teaching. So he needed somebody to do the pottery. So I got a job at 14 years old working for him.
And you just learned a lot of things through him, and obviously
actually
what you learned
through,
in school?
The man who became my partner later in life, Greg Zieber, Master Potter, I learned everything from him. We worked in a real small room together, and he was very knowledgeable.
And he was your partner for like 20 years until he unfortunately passed away from
pancreatic cancer. Yeah, he was a great teacher and friend, yes.
Now, when you guys were still working for Lester, you made an interesting connection.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about your Southern pottery pieces in the movie The Color Purple.
Oh, okay. Well, someone had called from the production people, and they wanted reproduction pottery to put in all the scenes. And that would have been something Lester would probably turn down, but I took the phone call, so I said, it's not a problem, we can do that. So we did, and we made
probably
the production.
Probably a yes that helped transform your life, maybe.
Maybe, yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because Oprah Winfrey was in that movie.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So from that, did that open the doors to some of these other celebrities? I was remiss. You're also a drummer, and you know a lot of people in the musical industry.
Yes. Why that was like a whole different angle.
But why rockers have known your stuff. But anyway, so after that happened, you and Greg opened your own business. And
sure.
Then what happened? You know, where? How did things get to the celebrity level?
My brother had some friends at record companies, so we were always going to concerts, and we were always meeting all these people. And we found that I always found that there's this common thread. Some of them did painting on the side or woodworking on the side, these other musicians. So we'd strike up a conversation, and they really got interested in what I did. And here I am, you know, with, you know, Def Leppard, and I'm interested in their whole career. So we struck up friendships, and, you know, they started to become customers of mine.
And Tommy Lee and Billy Idol.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so their homes are full of pretty many pieces.
Yeah. And Oprah bought some pieces from you after Color Purple,
some of the face jugs that I make, yes. Mm-hmm.
And also the actor William H. Macy's done a lot of business with you, right?
Yes, he's actually stopped by.
Here in Berks County?
Yes.
And
mm-hmm.
he's did you say we were chatting prior to going on the air, a wood maker?
He likes to do woodworking. And he stayed for about a half a day at my studio, and he had very peculiar questions. Like, he wanted to know how everything was made from beginning to end.
You think he's doing his own now, or?
No. I don't know. I hope he's stuck with woodworking. I don't know.
This is a real passion for you, a labor of love.
Oh, yeah. Right? 34 years now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it's still the creative rush that it always was?
Yes, it is. Yeah. I always have different ideas. I don't seem to have enough time to complete them.
Yeah. It's interesting because tell us, you know, how did the presidential angles come in? You know, it started with the Clintons. Tell me about that.
The Clintons wanted to do a Christmas tree in the White House made by all American craftsmen. So they put this out in Early American Life magazine looking for craftsmen that would participate. So, I jumped right on board for that. And it's through the White House Foundation. So after we did the tree, my wife and I were invited. We got a tour. We saw ornament on the tree.
Did you actually meet the Clintons?
No, they weren't there. Nice invitation, but they weren't there.
Yeah.
But then after that, the foundation would say, you know, can you make an anniversary plate? So I think after that, the Fords were the next. Gerald Ford, Jimmy Carter. And in fact, the Jimmy Carter plate is now in his library.
Oh, that! How cool is that? Yeah, they heard of you through what was
the White House Foundation. Yeah, that created this thing to make the ornaments.
And then, and also George H.W. Bush,
mm-hmm.
George W. Bush, excuse me.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And the Obamas.
Yes, the Obamas. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, made a couple interesting pieces for all of them. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah.
That's pretty nice to have in your resume.
Yeah. Yeah.
But the interesting thing with all the celebrity clients and with the presidential. Five of them. Mm-hmm. I mean, how many people can say they've done business with five U.S. presidents? Your most satisfaction is crafting pottery for people right here in Berks County.
Absolutely. I wouldn't have a business without them. Some of them line up an hour, 2 hours before a show. I mean, that's incredible.
That is.
I mean, it doesn't matter what the weather is.
So you're kind of like a rock star potter. You know?
That's funny.
Yeah. How many shows do you do a year?
Three.
Three.
Three is about all I can handle. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And some of your business people just see you on social media, Facebook, whatever.
Sure, Facebook, Instagram, and I do a lot of business. Most of my business through Facebook, and that's where you find these musicians. Actually, some of them do run their own pages.
Oh, okay. How many pieces do you think you've made? Probably infinite amount.
Gosh, I would have no idea.
Is this something you get better at the more you do?
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Sure, sure.
We're going to get to some images soon of the celebrities, but before we do that, and maybe, did you happen to bring an image of a face jug?
Sure.
Okay, mm-hmm. Because it was interesting, and you can explain more about that. I just thought it was interesting that a lot of the musicians seem to like the face jugs, which is what art made by, it's inspired by art made by African slaves in the Carolinas in Georgia.
Absolutely. Yes. Mm-hmm.
And it's interesting why that's so popular, but I guess...
Yeah, most of them didn't know the history to it.
Yeah.
And the more I told them the history, the more they liked them.
Wow.
Which was neat, because I'm really into the history part of all of it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I mean, you really know your profession inside and out.
I try. Yeah.
Well, anyway, I'm excited and as we show these images of celebrities and also you just pick up the narrative. Wesley.
Oh, that's one of my favorite photos taken by a friend, Scott St. John. Used to work at Y102.
I remember the name. Yeah.
Yeah, he's an incredible photographer. That's one of my favorite images. That's just an old, rundown piano with one of my face jugs on it. And you can see the little skull teeth.
Oh, I like that face jug.
Yeah.
The skull teeth, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Awesome.
Oh, and that's Rick Allen from Def Leppard and my family. When we get together, we usually have dinner first. And every summer we see him. You're probably at Hershey or, it's really, they're great people. That's William H. Macy in my home and my studio.
And what year was he here?
2017.
Okay. Oh, it was pretty recently.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He's a really good actor.
Yeah.
Why does he always use the H?
I don't know. I have no idea.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know.
And he's bought a lot of stuff from you, right?
Yeah. He has a relative in the area. That's why he's here.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. That's Fred Noe, the owner and great-grandson of Jim Beam.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I have a connection with him. I make some special jugs for special batches of bourbon for him.
Oh, that's a nice connection.
He is a great guy, yes.
Does he bring any Jim Beam along with him?
Always. Always.
Does that inspire the creativity?
No, actually, that's a funny thing. People always ask that, if anything, like any chemicals inspire anything.
Yeah.
No, I don't do that until I'm done working.
Now, when you're working, speaking of inspiration, you're a musician. Do you listen to music when you're creating?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Really loud, too.
Yeah, I figured that. Yeah. What do you like? What's your favorites?
Right now, my favorite is like Rival Sons, Richie Kotzen, who's from here.
Okay.
Yeah, guitarist, songwriter. He's one of my favorite and one of my favorite guys to work with as a client.
These artists love you.
Yeah, he's a great guy.
Yeah. And your son obviously is a drummer and actually doing very well.
Yeah, he's
now
in a band, Roland, in New Jersey.
Oh.
His EP comes out this fall.
Oh,
sure.
It really is an art. He doesn't do any pottery though, huh?
No, he helps with odds and ends though.
Yeah.
Yeah, at the holidays. Yeah, I kind of have to draft him to help a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah. No,
that's what fathers do to kids.
That's right. Uh-huh. Oh, that's the best members of Guns N' Roses.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. They weren't on the list, but I love Guns N' Roses.
Yes.
You
yes.
have to listen to them a little bit when you're
Yes, crazy. I do. And that was the band they formed after Velvet Revolver. That's why there's a third man there.
Okay.
In the band. But all three of them have separately ordered stuff. Matt Sorum, Duff McKagan, Slash.
You know, Slash just had a birthday, because I saw it in the paper. Yeah, they always put celebrity birthdays.
Mm-hmm.
And he wears the hat all the time, even if...
I've seen him without the hat.
Yeah.
I've seen him without the hat.
He is really talented.
He is.
Yeah.
He really is.
And what do we have next?
That's another picture from Scott St. John that he took of me at an old abandoned school.
And that's another face
job. Yeah, that's a larger one. You can see the size of it.
Yeah.
That's in a private collection locally, though. I know. I recognize it. Someone locally bought that piece.
What does Scott do now that he's not doing the radio for 102?
You know what? He has a day job. I don't remember what it is. I apologize. I don't remember. But I always look at him as a photographer because he's very talented.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
That's actually called a Hogmanay bottle. Hogmanay bottle is named after the Scottish New Year. It's made in three pieces. You got to make the donut, you got to make the spout, and the base. And you put your arm through that, and they would go out, the Scottish potters, and celebrate New Year's. Most of them didn't survive, if you know what I mean. They would drop the vessel.
Oh, I thought the people didn't survive.
No, maybe they didn't survive.
I thought, what
either.
Were they drinking?
Well, you don't know. But that's one of my favorite really pieces to make, but it's very challenging to do those three pieces. And then, you know, liquid flows through that circle.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
How long would it take to make a piece like that? And how precise you have to be, and how many remakes do you have to do?
I don't have remakes, luckily, anymore. But and that's a funny question. Some famous artist, and I can't remember who it was, they asked the same thing. How long does it take to do that? For me, it would be 34 years.
That's a good answer.
Because I really couldn't tell you exactly, down to the minute, how long it takes to make. Because I do a lot of things at one time.
Okay, you're moving on.
I might be working on that and a face jug at the same time.
And that's just because you have to wait for it. Pardon my naivety.
No, that's fine. Yeah, it's
to cure or whatever.
Naturally cure. You have to let nature take its course with this stuff. Yeah. You can't rush it. You can't. That's the beauty of it.
You have to compartmentalize to a degree, though. You're working on this, working on
that. Sure, all different parts. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I love that you can't rush this thing. Like, so much is rushed today. Everything's rushed.
How do you price these things? I mean, to me, that would be worth so much money.
Some of it's time, the expertise to make it, the amount of glaze material, all of it. It all gets added up.
Mm-hmm. You obviously have a website.
Sure, yeah.
Share it with people.
NoldeForestPottery.com.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I knew that, but I wanted them to know that.
Okay, all right.
And feel free, if you saw the show and you're intrigued, to reach out to Wesley. Now, tell us about this.
That is one of my favorite techniques. That's called English combware. You put all those colors in, and you kind of use a metal comb to go through. They do it with, like, ice things at fancy restaurants. Same concept.
Okay.
Yeah. But the English did that. That was, and...
Now, that's a plate?
Yeah, that's a plate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's, like, you can use that to microwave, bake, eat off every day, dishwasher.
Do people do that?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
Well, it's interesting you should say that, because, and I got this information, I guess, maybe from your website, but, you know, your pottery, Nolde Forest, has a wide variety of pieces available that can be personalized for special occasions, such as weddings, birth announcements, birthdays, and awards. Custom-made freehand originals are also available upon request. And this is what struck me, because I thought people would just use them for showcase. All pieces are food safe and dishwasher safe and adhere to strict standards. And I'm thinking, you know, I don't know what you charge for something like that, but I think I wouldn't want to put it in a dishwasher.
Well, that's actually not too expensive, so you wouldn't feel too bad about using it.
Now, do you guys, you and your wife, your family, do you ever eat off these things?
I get in a little trouble because my wife's the last to get stuff.
It always works that
but
way.
But we have some bowls and stuff in the kitchen.
It's like guys who renovate homes or they're home builders. Their own homes are a wreck because the last thing we're going to do is come home and work around there.
It's the same thing, yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that's funny. Okay, what do we have here?
Oh, that's Rob Zombie. He's a singer, producer of horror films.
I've heard of
writer, him. Yeah. Wrote a few books.
His given name, I don't believe.
No, it's not. I'll keep that a secret. But that's a piece I made for him. You can see he really liked it.
Yeah.
But that ended up on one of his tour shirts.
Oh,
that
wow.
image. Yeah. That was taken by a photographer named Rob Fenn, who I'm not positive where he's located. He shoots a lot of musicians when they're on tour.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's a great picture.
That is. Yeah. That is. Yeah. Now, where is that? He has that, right?
Yeah, he has that. Mm-hmm.
Do you keep anything for your own? Do you ever make a duplicate for your own private stash?
I don't have too much of my own things, no.
Really?
No.
Because once you create it, it's kind of gone.
I like the whole one of a kind. When it comes to somebody like that, and I think that's why they do come to me, you can get something one of a kind that you can't find anywhere.
Yeah, you were telling me, because I asked you prior as we were chatting, explain a little bit what makes you somewhat unique in the pottery world, because you've created a little bit more of a new style.
Sure. I mean, I started with, traditional redware, which I still do.
Yeah.
But I study different pottery from around the world. And as I do, I learn more history, I learn more techniques, colors.
Yeah.
And I also add, some of my stuff has a modern twist to it.
How do you study it? Google?
I still Google. I have a huge collection of books.
Okay.
I still buy a lot of books.
Okay.
And sit and read books on my craft. Never always learn every day if you can.
And they have a lot of images in there?
Sure.
Mm-hmm. You're going to wind up in some of those books, or maybe you are already.
Mm-hmm. I hope so. Maybe. Yeah. I don't think I'm in any yet.
Do you have any more images? Or?
There's a traditional piece. That's traditional redware.
There's something elegant about traditional, though, too.
Yeah. Right? I make it a little fancier than normal. But, yeah, that's... So, I mean, those are the traditional roots. I'll never give that up.
Yeah. Now, do you sketch things out first, or you just do it?
I really don't like to, but sometimes I do.
Yeah.
Yeah. If I'm doing a reproduction for a museum, of course I have to sketch it.
Yeah. Why don't you like to otherwise? Just because does it retard the creative process? Or
a little bit.
Yeah.
Because, those images are all carved in with, like, a metal tool, not a pencil. So it's a whole different thing, like...
Oh, wow.
Yeah, it's pretty neat. And you make a mistake, that's it.
No pressure there.
No.
It always amazed me, like, we'll talk about this image in a minute,
okay.
But what people can do with their hands. And, mm-hmm. When my wife and I were in Italy a few years ago, mm-hmm. the statue of David, or mm-hmm. they say David.
Sure.
That is, I don't know if you've ever saw it up
close
in person. Yeah. That's amazing. How did a guy with a hammer and chisel do
right,
that?
Right.
And, to a certain degree, you do things on a smaller scale mm-hmm. that way.
Yeah.
How do you, are you very, have a lot of great manual dexterity, I would assume.
Sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, you have to, I think. It's an interesting concept. I had a discussion with, I don't remember which musician it was. He was talking about, there's a bridge from here to your, whatever you do with your hands.
Yeah.
But along the way, you study, you learn from other people, you're inspired. Like, I'm inspired by, Salvador Dali, Keith Haring.
Yeah,
They're not potters, but, and all that stuff leads to what you can do with your hands.
Yeah.
It's like a bridge,
But there's also, when you're working on it, there's a bridge between your head and your hands mm-hmm. while you're doing it.
Sure.
I find that as a writer, that I sometimes, I'll think of things when I'm not at a keyboard, mm-hmm. but it's not the same. When I'm on the keyboard, it flows better. It's almost like my fingers and mind work together.
Okay.
I don't know if that's similar to what you're talking about, mm-hmm. but that's just struck me.
Yeah. And it's interesting to me, even how I got there. Like, how do I get to that piece from what?
Yeah.
But then, you're inspired by so many things in life.
Yeah. Are you constantly looking for things, or you're just...
I think I really focus on things more than people do.
Yeah.
If I go see a painting at a gallery or something, I'll look at it a lot longer.
Yeah, it was interesting. There is a... this. She's not really a jazz artist. She's kind of like a crossover. Her name is Keiko Matsui. Mm-hmm. She's a great pianist and keyboard player. Mm-hmm. She's been to Berks Jazz Fest a lot. She's a rock star in Eastern Europe. There'll be 30,000 people at a concert in Russia. She's big in Russia and Eastern Europe and also mm-hmm. South Africa. Mm-hmm. But she was telling me, and I profiled her in a big piece one time, she basically catches melodies, like she'll be looking at the ocean or whatever, and they just come to her. She's not consciously, it's almost like her subconscious. Mm-hmm. She's just catching melodies.
From the sound of nature and
absolutely. And I think artists have a different, you hear things differently,
Oh, I believe that.
Yeah.
Sure. You mean you hear music differently, probably?
Yeah.
I agree.
The image which we didn't talk about, the one thanks guys.
That was just a recent piece. I thought I'd put a picture up of, that's like a 20-inch serving platter. You put like a turkey on it.
It's a shame to cover it with a turkey, but right. What a great Thanksgiving piece.
Yeah, sure.
So is that currently for sale?
No. That was actually, I just donated it to I had a high school friend was doing a fundraiser for leukemia in Harrisburg. I made that for him to auction off. It's been auctioned off.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, I do a lot of charity work, too. It's important.
Do you really?
Sure, absolutely.
Not to put you on the spot here, but here BCTV has a tremendous fundraiser every year in October with a lot of TV exposure called Oktoberfest.
Okay.
Let's talk after
all
the
right,
show.
All right, let's talk. All right.
I think Bill Martin, our general manager, will join the Yeah, I just happened to think about that. That's awesome. So, so you have a charitable bent.
Sure.
It's nice that you give back.
You have to.
Yeah. Oh, cool.
Mm-hmm.
Any other images? Or is that basically
I think they went through them all.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. You're pretty prolific, aren't you? In terms of you're working all the time.
Yes, yeah. I always say it's not work, though.
Yeah.
I can't ever complain about the
hours. Do you ever get, you know, they talk about, I've never had it, they talk about writer's block. Do you ever have like a creative block, like you're thinking about, well, what am I going to do next, you know?
No, I've never had that.
Yeah, good, good. You don't want to think
about
it.
I'm running out of time, that's my problem. Like, I have not enough time in a day.
Yeah.
Like, I don't have a clock in my studio.
Not always a good thing, right?
I don't like it. I don't like time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you're always late for dinner?
No, I'm never late for anything.
What do you have, a clock, internal clock?
Or? Cell phone.
Oh, wow. Yeah. And you were telling me you work 6 days a week, unless you're on the road.
Yeah, usually I've had my business 25 years, Nolde Forest Pottery. I bet I worked every Saturday other than I took a couple vacations.
Now, in your travels, do you go to other potters just to see what they're doing?
You know what? I try not to do that. I have a lot of people say, you know, oh, you got to go see this potter, that potter. I'd rather go see like a glass blower. I really like glass blowers. Museums, painters. Mm-hmm. I really don't need to see any more pottery.
Okay.
Because I have enough of my own ideas and, yeah.
Do you ever think about painting? Do you have any of them?
I was an oil painter in college.
Yeah, because you did. What'd you major in art?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You don't do any painting now, or
I have never gone back to painting. I always wish to do it one day. I always say one day, but I don't know how I'll fit it in.
Yeah, so it's not like you don't want to do it. You just don't have time.
No, I would love to. Yeah. But I sold all my paintings when I was to pay for college, so I don't own any.
Wow, you are good. See, the thing is, you got to be good at this, right? Uh-huh. I mean, there's a lot of people who are starving artists, right, but you're not a starving artist.
No. I did have one of our paintings, though. I painted one for Lester Breininger, and whoever was in charge of the estate returned it to me.
Oh, okay.
So it's kind of nice I have the one I painted for him.
It was interesting, too. He was a biology teacher, but a very creative guy. You think it's scientists, it's not creative.
Partially with him, he had an incredible antique collection. So a lot of time we were doing repros for him.
Okay.
He never admitted to be an artist. He always told me that's why he hired people like me to draw for him.
Oh, okay. You know, but it's a different mindset. It seems like people who are really good at math and science, maybe not artistic.
Right. But he was super good with history, antiques, and he found talent to get together and make all this stuff.
And Ferdy obviously lived long enough to see a lot of your success.
Sure. Yeah. Absolutely. He would visit as long as he could at my studio.
Now, he was primarily a painter, though, personally, right?
He did some pottery.
Did he?
He did some stained glass. I mean, probably a lot of people don't know all that. And every year he would draw an incredible Christmas card with ink and pen.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Back in the day when people did Christmas cards.
Yeah, he still did. I cherish him.
Yeah. We only have a couple minutes left. What did I miss? What do you want to share that might be interesting?
34 years, oh my gosh, I don't...
Any celebrities we missed or interesting stories?
Wow, you put me on the spot. I could have a lot of stories, but...
Well, the clean ones.
The clean ones. I did. Funny with the Billy Idol thing, that was a funny story. He actually played at Reading when I delivered a sculpture to him and actually made me nervous because he ran around on stage with it.
Uh-oh.
And luckily he didn't
good
drop it.
That was good PR work.
Lucky he didn't drop it. He did. It was great PR work, but I was so glad he didn't drop it.
Oh, yeah. He would have to make another one.
Yeah. Probably, yeah.
How fragile, that's a good point, how fragile are your pieces?
They are kind of fragile.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know.
Yeah.
Some can survive a little bit. I mean, the dinnerware is pretty durable.
I was going to say, that probably is.
Yeah, fire at 2,000 degrees, that's pretty tough.
Whoa.
Yeah.
How hot is it in your studio?
Oh, man, we have some hot days. No air conditioning.
Is that by design?
Yeah. It would cancel each other out. Kind of a waste of electric. Yeah. I mean, I live next to Nolde Forest. Have the doors open. It's pretty beautiful out there.
Yeah. Well, that's a nice artistic setting, too.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, look out and see that. Can't beat it.
Do you ever walk in the forest out there?
All the time. I hike all the time.
What was the secret to your success besides having the talent? Just persistence, hard drive?
Persistence, hard work. It's hard to make art a business.
Yes, but you have.
And the only way to do it is by a lot of hours.
And your parents were supportive?
Always.
Because they could have told you, go get an accounting degree.
I left college before graduating and they didn't say anything about it. Because I said, I'm going to start this pottery business.
They didn't say anything about it. Well, you're a different parent than I was.
I think they believed in me, I guess.
Yeah, well,
I'm sure they did.
Yeah.
I know my mom and dad.
How many semesters short were you?
Two, I think.
You never had the urge to go back and finish?
No, you know what? Once I started, I never looked back.
Yeah. Where'd you go?
I finished up at Alvernia my last years. I loved it there, though.
Yeah. Where'd you start out at?
I went to Rack for a couple terms. I went to Kutztown for a term. They were so backed up, I couldn't get any art classes anyway. So I moved on.
Yeah.
But I found a good home in Alvernia. I liked it.
Yeah. Oh. Mm-hmm. Well, you know what? Just shows you, there's a lot of college graduates who aren't making any money, and then there's a lot of people who are successful.
I hear that. We have that discussion all the time with people.
Yeah.
And, I'm a bad example, to say. I kind of left college. But, I mean, I believe in education. I mean, I learned
a ton. I understand. Well, you have a unique skill, and obviously you're very talented. And it's been a real joy to have you, Wesley Muckey. Please check out his website, NoldeForestPottery.com, if you're interested. What a great Christmas present for someone, or a birthday present, or whatever.
Thank you.
Keep on rocking and hanging out with the president. All right, for now, this is Mike Slinsky saying goodbye.